which one don't we sing on?
A Little Town of Bethlehem.
Okay. Well, yeah.
We don't know that.
Okay. That'll be before then. Oh, God.
What is Noel in place of?
Noel in place of Bethlehem. Okay. So make sure you're feeling a little. Come on.
Good morning. Merry Christmas on this beautiful, beautiful Christmas day that we get to celebrate on Sunday. We are glad that you are here, that you've made it this morning on this beautiful Christmas morning. Again, we welcome you. We hope you felt welcome in coming in this morning. Hope you've also received an order of worship on your way in. A few things I would like to point out to you, a few that are in the order of worship. If you open it up, you can see a whole list of announcements, things coming up, going on in the life of the church. I want to point out to you, just for sake of time, and I also hope that you will take the time later to read all the announcements, not just the ones I'm talking about, but all of them, so you yourself know what's going on. Don't forget about our sermon series beginning Sunday, January the 8th, and then also our United Methodist men are not meeting next Sunday. They're meeting the 8th, the second Sunday of the month. So all men, just keep that in mind, that you'll be meeting the second Sunday of the month. Also, inside your order for the calendar of the week, hopefully you saw an email that went out yesterday. The bulletins were printed before that email went out. But in your bulletin, you have next Sunday's times there, and we're not following those times for New Year's Day. Okay? New Year's Day, we're going to follow the same schedule we have for this morning. 10 a.m. worship, and we'll get back into our regular routine, regular schedule on Sunday, January the 8th, with Sunday school at 9:45 and worship at 11. We'll be sending out another email reminder, but just wanted to kind of put that out there vocally to you also. And then something different happened this past week. The Christmas meals were not prepared and served on Christmas, as always, for the Haven of Rest from Abbeville all the way to Anderson. But it happened on Friday, the 23rd, and there were a huge amount of people coming to volunteer to help pack food, deliver food. And Rayford gave me a count this morning. There were over 625 meals prepared and delivered just in Abbeville. You know, and it's up in the thousands when you go from Abbeville to Anderson. So all of you who helped give, who helped support this ministry, who helped participate in it, just a big thank you for everything that you helped do to help feed folks who are hungry. Finally, just a word. You know, I spoke last week about this beginning a small group, and small groups beginning this year, and I told you more information is coming, but just wanted to remind us all of a few things. Small groups are how it sounds. It is a group of people, a small group of people who come together, they fellowship, they talk about what's going on in their life, they read scripture, they talk about the scripture, talk about how it applies to their life, and they help hold each other accountable. And that's what we need as a church, as a body of believers. And see, we are United Methodist. That's what it says on the sign, and that's who we are. The United Methodist denomination did not begin as a denomination. It began as small groups meeting. Did you know about that? That's history of who we are. This thing called United Methodist was a movement, and it happened. It moved people, and it changed lives because small groups of folks came together and did life together. And just even a little more history about us, specific Grace. Do y'all know how we began? And just another note, Grace is, this church is not named after the grace of God, by the way. It's named after a lady whose name was Grace. And she was responsible for when the church was down on South Main. She was the one responsible going to homes and praying for people and talking about Scripture. That's how we began as a church. Small groups are important. And just one more visual. I showed this a while back, but it's worth sharing again, I think, because we only learn what we already know. If this is the beginning point of your life and your journey with Christ, and we want to grow as disciples and end up way over here, there's no way possible, no way possible, from this physical location to that physical location, you can make it in one giant step or even one big jump. You have to have small steps along the way. And what that means is if we're going to grow as disciples, we have to create the steps to make it happen. And I believe when we begin small group ministries, in addition to our Sunday schools, in addition to Bible studies that are already going on, when you begin to gather as small groups of people, whether you're gathering in your home, whether you're gathering here at the church, whether you're gathering at a restaurant, and you do this every week for at least 2 hours a week, or an hour and a half a week, you're going to begin to create the steps to make it possible to get to where you want to be as a follower of Jesus. And I say all that to say, if you did not sign up last week and you're interested in small groups, I would encourage you to sign up today. The sign-up sheet is up front. It will be out there on your way out. If you did not sign up last week, and you want more information about it, you're going to hear more advertisements coming the next few weeks. But if you want to go ahead and sign up and get on the roster, then I would encourage you to do that this morning on your way out. One final word about small groups, and it's on the front of your order of worship. And it says this: a life connected to God and a life connected to one another is the most meaningful life there is. A life connected to God and a life connected to one another is the most meaningful life there is. And I'm convinced the hour or hour and a half that you spend at church every Sunday here is not going to make as big an impact as the hour and a half you'll spend in a small group. All right, that's my final commercial today. I would invite you to stand with me. As we are reminded of this faith we say we claim, this faith in Christ, this faith in who God is, we remind ourselves of these words from the Apostles' Creed, these words passed down from generation to generation in the life of the church. These words, the basics, the fundamentals, the foundation of the Christian faith. Let us join together with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day He rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
And if you could please remain standing. You know, we read about in the Bible how the angels sang the night that Jesus Christ was born. And can you imagine hearing the angels singing on that night and how awesome the sound that would be? Well, that's why this morning we're going to do a little angel medley. And we get the opportunity and the chance to sing along just like the angels did. So I want to hear y'all sing along with this with us this morning. Bethlehem and see.
Come to Bethlehem and see. Come as your own man did me. Christ the Lord, the new born. angels from the realms of glory.
Angels from the realms of glory, wing your flight o'er all the earth. He who sang creation's glory, now proclaim Messiah's birth. Come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King.
Heard the herald angels sing. Gloria.
This time I would ask all the children to come up, and if you brought a gift with you, to bring your gift with you. My word. Come on up, boys and girls, if you'd like. If you don't have a gift and want to come up, that's still cool. I'm not sure what to think about a gun in church, but hey. Oh, you got an air horn. Oh, no, that is not an air horn. I just read the label. I will not repeat. Y'all can check it out after. Pretty cool, though. We're going to just kind of have a little special something. All right, Thomas, what's one thing you got for Christmas, buddy? An iPod. Miss Savannah, what did you get? So you gonna be singing like Mommy now, huh? You're going to take Mommy's job. Is that what's going to happen? Yeah. Anyone, you got a scooter? Niles' a scooter. Okay. What did you get, Harper? A train. You got a bunny. You got that. Oh, I heard it. What kind of bunny you have? You don't know? Well, that's cool. Mason, what did you get for Christmas? The game Bounce Off? No, I don't. But I don't know that game. We'll have to check that out sometime. Brady. My goodness, son. A doom buggy. Like me, you got a Nerf gun, too. Nerf cannon. Trent, what'd you get, bud? Right on. And a football helmet. Woo! What's going on, Mr. Andrew? What'd you get? A laser range finder. That's pretty awesome. Because you deer slayer, right? That's what I thought. Mac, what's a Lego pullback racer? And you already put it together. Is that it? Good job. All right, Burdette boys, what did y'all get? A helmet? Oh, I thought y'all had helmets just so y'all could wrestle around. Y'all got them for four-wheelers. I hear you. Awesome. Y'all already ride them already this morning? All right. Brian, what'd you get, buddy? A what? RC car. Thing's fast, ain't it? It looks pretty fast. Well, boys and girls, we are, we're getting ready to sing. We are very, very blessed by our parents and people who love us, and we're especially blessed by God because He gave us the best gift ever, and that's His Son, Jesus Christ. And that's why we have Christmas. So, let's have a special prayer. I want to pray for you and thank God for the many, many gifts that He gives to us. Let's pray together. Almighty God, I thank you so much for this day. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your Son, Jesus. God, I thank you for these boys and girls, and Lord, for their families, for the people who love them. Lord, who not only provide for them things that they need, but also things they want. God, I thank you for the blessing of the gifts they have received. Lord God, I pray that you would to keep them, and Lord, keep them safe. And Lord, just continue to work in the lives of these boys and girls, and that they may grow and know more and more the love and grace of your Son, Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. All right, thank you all very much. Y'all have a Merry Christmas. I thought you were leaving that for me. Nuh-uh, okay.
All right, let's stand again as we continue our worship.
You may be seated. Let us continue worshiping God with God's tithe and our offering as we have a chance to give back to God a portion of what is God's with God's tithe and to go beyond that giving of a tithe and give an offering. And again, just a reminder, the pictures you see on the screen each week are just many pictures of what our giving provides for not only this church, but this community and this world. Our giving helps make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. So I would invite you to give as you are able, and let us pray together this morning. Gracious God, again, we thank you so much for the amazing gift of your Son, Jesus. Lord God, you gave him for all the world. You gave up your very best so that we, at our very worst, could be in relationship with you. We thank you for that amazing love. We thank you for that amazing grace. Heavenly Father, I ask that we would give back now as we are able, God, your tithe and our offering. And Holy Spirit, I pray and I ask that you would bless, you would multiply the giving, the receiving in this place. And God, I pray, and I pray in faith, believing that lives will be changed by the good news of Jesus Christ. Because of how Grace United Methodist Church gives. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
In the bulletin it says we're going to be singing "O Little Town of Bethlehem," but we're actually doing a different song. Some of you heard it last Wednesday. It's called "Noel." And I just want to read you the chorus because it kind of sums up everything. It says, "Noel, Noel, come and see what God has done. Noel, Noel, the story of amazing love, the light of the world given for us. Noel."
And now we ask that you stand together with us as we present God's tithes and our offerings. You can be seated.
Just a quick word. Thanks, Alan and Eric, for stepping up and helping out Todd this morning. He's a little short-handed. Appreciate that. And Todd, thank you for what you do every week. That a lot of times goes unnoticed until something don't work. Then everybody's like, "But I appreciate y'all guys, man." Last night, if you were here, you know, we talked some about Mary, mainly Mary, a little bit about Mary and Joseph, and we left this idea that God wants to use you. He wants to use you, and really, what it means for us is we need to just start saying to God, "Lord, have your way in my life," because God wants to use you. And I told you last night, if you were here, that if you come or if you came today, it would be like getting part two. So there you go. Today we're going to talk a little bit about Joseph and how that relates to the story of Jesus and Jesus coming into this world. And I want to begin it this way. I would imagine that every one of us have something in common. At least one thing, and here's the at least one thing. Every one of us have family members. And every one of us have family members that we oftentimes will look at them and think, "Are we from the same gene pool?" You can say amen if you can relate to that. All right, so I was just making sure I wasn't alone in this, because we can think about some family and we think, "Seriously?" And then somebody may say, "Hey, I heard you were kin to," and you're like, "Shh, don't tell everybody that." Or, "I heard you were cousins with," yeah, but that's like third or fourth cousins. They don't even count, you know. Or if you're from the South, you call that creek kin. So, you know, we all have family members like that. And as I think about all the family ties that we have, some we're very proud of, some we think, "I'm not sure I want people to think that I know them," you know, that kind of deal. I always remember, I heard comedian Jeff Foxworthy say years and years ago, he says, "But here's the deal with your family. If you ever want to feel better about your family, just go to the state fair. You will feel like royalty when you leave." You know, and since today's Christmas, and we're talking about family, I've got a little image for y'all I want to throw up on the screen. Guys, if you'll pull that up there for me. Y'all recognize that movie? That fella from the movie? National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation? Remember Cousin Eddie? So everybody's thinking about your family member. Well, you just may be that family member. You never know. So keep that in mind too. But anyway, all right, moving on. Thanks, guys. We all have some family issues. We all have a family tree. We all have maybe even family problems. But here's what I know about you, and here's what I know about me, and here's what I know about everyone in this world. God wants to use you, and here's even a bigger tidbit of information coming at you. It's your takeaway, it's your bottom line today. Not only does God want to use you, God can use you. Last night we talked about God wants to use you. That's not the right one. That's okay though. God can use you. If you have your Bibles, I would ask you to turn with me to the Gospel of Matthew, the very first chapter, beginning in the very first verse. Matthew chapter 1, beginning in verse 1. We're going to read verses 1 through 17, and I will try not to butcher every name this here. And as you're turning there, you know, a lot of times we skip over these portions of Scripture. you start reading and you see all these names and you're like, I can't even have that. Who? And you're like, nah, okay. And you'll get to the part after that. Do you do that? Raise your hand. I mean, I do that sometimes too. I'm not going to stand up here and tell you I don't. But there's some important information in these names. So we're going to read through the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah, beginning in verse 1. An account of the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac the father of Jacob, and Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers, and Judah the father of Perez and Zerah by Tamar. Keep that in mind. We'll come back to her. And Perez the father of Hezron, and Hezron the father of Aram, and Aram the father of Amminadab, and Amminadab the father of Nahshon, and Nahshon the father of Salmon, and Salmon the father of Boaz by Rahab, and Boaz the father of Obed by Ruth, and Obed the father of Jesse, and Jesse the father of King David. Whew, let me breathe. And David was the father of Solomon by the wife of Uriah. And Solomon the father of Rehoboam, and Rehoboam the father of Abijah, and Abijah the father of Asaph, and Asaph the father of Jehoshaphat, Jehoshaphat the father of Joram, and Joram the father of Uzziah, and Uzziah the father of Jotham, and Jotham the father of Ahaz, and Ahaz the father of Hezekiah, Hezekiah the father of Manasseh, Manasseh the father of Amos, Amos the father of Josiah, Josiah the father of Jeconiah and his brothers at the time of the deportation to Babylon. Whew. Breathe again. And after the deportation to Babylon, Jeconiah was the father of Salathiel, and Salathiel the father of Zerubbabel, and Zerubbabel the father of Abiad, and Abiad the father of Elikiam, and Elikiam the father of Azor, and Azor the father of Zadok, and Zadok the father of Akim, and Akim the father of Eliud, and Eliud the father of Eleazar, Eleazar the father of Mathan, and Mathan the father of Jacob, and Jacob the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, of whom Jesus was born, who is called the Messiah. So all the generations from Abraham to David, all 14 generations. And from David to the deportation to Babylon, 14 generations. And from the deportation to Babylon to the Messiah, 14 generations. And just a word about reading names in Scripture. Just read them with confidence. Don't matter if you pronounce it right, because nobody else knows either. There you go. What's so important about all of this? Well, I think it helps answer the question, who is Jesus Christ? Because that's really what Matthew's gospel is beginning with. Who is this Jesus Christ? And he begins, and you have it titled in your Bible, the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah, or the genealogy of Jesus is titled that way to let you know who is Jesus Christ. You see, this question can have a variety of answers. And Matthew's gospel begins with an interesting way of helping to identify Jesus and our asking the question, who is Jesus Christ? And another little trivial side note, Christ was not Jesus' last name. Okay? I don't know what his last name was, but it wasn't Christ. That's another way of saying Messiah, the promised one, the anointed one. Just a side note. But Matthew helps us in this very first chapter understand who is this Jesus Christ. And I love that Matthew doesn't take some theological approach. He doesn't take some theological approach of saying, he was the only Son of God. Of God, is God, very same substance of God. No, he doesn't take that approach. He takes a very real approach. He jumps right in to a human perspective. He gives a list of the genealogy of Jesus from Joseph's side of the family. And see, that's significant. And one reason it's significant is because this Messiah, this promised one, this Christ would be of the line of David. And Matthew is very intentional in making sure his audience knows this is the promised one. And so he gives this human perspective through Jesus' genealogy. And here's why I think it's important to not just skip over those names like we've all been guilty of doing at times when you come to Scripture and you're reading like, ain't going there, buddy, next page. Here's why it's significant, because if you don't recognize those names, it may be good to go back to the Old Testament. If you're in the New Testament, go back to the Old Testament and try to find what who they are. Their names are listed for a reason. And I'm just going to pick out a few. I'm not going to talk about all of them because we'd be here till next Sunday. But I'm just going to pick out a few. And it begins this way. And we're going to talk about just two of the guys and then a few of the ladies in the list. But it begins this way. Abraham was the father of Isaac. Here's something about Abraham. See, Matthew picks up with Abraham, but you know there were people that existed before Abraham. You ever heard of a guy named Noah? But you know, he had three sons. One of his sons was Shem, and through his descendants came Abraham. So we begin with Abraham, but here's why I want to say that. Do you remember about Noah? What did Noah do? What did he do when he got off that ark? He planted a vineyard. What happened after he planted that vineyard? He got hammered. Then he got naked. That's in the Bible. Go read it. Why am I telling you that? Because he's part of the line of bringing Jesus to this world. And if God can use Noah to bring Jesus to this world, God can use you to bring Jesus to this world. There's another name listed in here. A fellow by the name of Jacob. You ever read about Jacob? He had a brother. You remember Jacob's brother's name? Esau. See, we got some folks who listen in Sunday school. Esau. What was Jacob? What was one thing Jacob was known for? Wrestling with God from the very beginning when he was coming out of the womb. Holding on to his brother's heel. And that followed him the rest of his life because he was known as a trickster, a manipulator, a deceiver. Like some people that we maybe know. But here's what I also know. If God can use Jacob to bring Jesus into this world, God can use you to bring Jesus into this world. Let's talk about some of these women, because here's what's also significant in looking at this word with all these names. Matthew, writing his gospel to a predominantly Jewish audience, and more times than not, in fact, almost never, were women's names listed in the genealogy of people. Hardly ever to never were women's names listed in the genealogy of people. It was always the father's name begat, the father's name begat, the father's name begat, so on and so forth. Hardly ever the woman's name. But there's a name, there's one name there, a woman by the name of Tamar. You can read about her in Genesis 38. But just to give you a little tidbit of information about Tamar, Tamar disguised herself as a prostitute and had a little bit of a relationship with her father-in-law. If God can use her to bring Jesus into this world, God can use you to bring Jesus into this world. There's another woman named there, Rahab. Again, a prostitute. You can read about her in Joshua chapter 2. She was a Canaanite prostitute who hid Israelite soldiers. And the Israelite soldiers knew she was there. And I would have wondered why they would know she was there. I'll let you figure that one out. Go read Joshua 1 and 2. You'll get it. But if God can use Rahab to bring Jesus into this world, God can use you, church, to bring Jesus into this world. And then Matthew lists another woman by the name of Ruth. Ruth wasn't even a Jew. She was a Gentile, a despised woman from a Jew's perspective. But here she is in the line of the Messiah. If God can use a Gentile, God can use you. Then there's another name, except for Matthew doesn't say it. The woman's name is Bathsheba. But if you notice in your reading in verse 6, it says, and David was the father of Solomon by the wife of Uriah. Matthew don't even name her. She was so bad, he's like, I ain't putting her in there. I'll just say the wife of Uriah. If you remember that story, she was the one, her husband was all fighting, and she went and hung out with King David for a little while, and they had a baby. God can use the wife of Uriah, a.k.a. Bathsheba. God can use you. Four women listed, minus Mary, that would be five, but four women listed. Three of those of a questionable reputation. If you're a fellow, that would be the kind of women your parents would suggest you not hang around with. One of those not even a Jew. You see what I'm saying here, church? If God can use all those people with all those problems and all of Jesus' family tree to bring Jesus into this world, God can use you with all your brokenness, with all your problems, with all your struggles, no matter who your family is, no matter where you've been, no matter what you've done. If God can use all these people, God can use you to bring Jesus into this world. There's no excuse for us. We have a mission, and it is to bring Jesus to this world. And God can use you. They were all vessels of bringing Jesus to this earth. Today's Christmas. Jesus has come. And Jesus comes to us every day through the power of the Holy Spirit to be in relationship with us. And Jesus is coming back. And until He does, we have a job, church. It's our job to tell the world about Jesus. It's our job to bring Jesus to the world. And if God can use all those messed up people, God can surely use the people of Grace United Methodist Church. We might be bad, but we ain't that bad. We said that before. I might be bad, but I ain't that bad. We might be bad, but we ain't as bad as them people listed in Jesus' genealogy. If God can use them, God can use us. Will you let Him? Jesus is here. Hope is here. Peace is here. Love is here. Grace is here. And His name is Jesus. And it's our job to tell the world God can use you. Let us pray. Almighty God, I thank You for that list of names of messed up people. Because, God, we pretty messed up ourselves. But thanks be to You, Almighty God, sending Your Son Jesus that would save us from our messed up selves, that would save us from our broken lives, that would save us from our sin and our life that's headed to hell, that would save us from a living hell. Jesus, thank You. And Jesus, use us, because I believe, God, that You can use us to bring Jesus to this world. And let it begin one person at a time sharing the love of Jesus. In His holy name we pray. Amen.
Let's sing together. And I think I mentioned it the other night when we sang this song, that it's actually one of our favorite songs. And we have a good time with it. So you are invited to put your hands together. You're not going to get in trouble if you clap your hands. So we want y'all to have a good time with this song.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. My shame.
sang it good. We got to live it better. We got to go tell somebody. We got to show somebody. And it's time for the church to leave the building. I hope we all, hope you all have a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. And we have good news, church, and His name is Jesus. And let us go in the good news and the love of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let's join hands together.